something about policy analysis and conflict negotiation, and essentially continuing of ending the module started by
Should I be, or should I just start?
I think you should start.
Okay. Good morning. No.
आगे सबसे आगे चलिए शरीफ शरीफ बच्चे सब
Assalamualaikum everyone. I'm just going to start and finish off module 4, which Rafe started. He gave us his overview of Pakistani water law, international water law. And you've all taken Dr. Afreen's course on systems analysis. So if you merge systems analysis with a little bit of law and the socio-political context, you come to policy analysis. This is just my introduction. So we basically have three sections. We'll begin with the history of policy analysis and how it relates to water. Then some of the techniques used for analysis. Dr. Afreen mentioned systems analysis, but there are a few other basic ones. We'll just quickly go over them. And then how do we manage water resource conflict and what are the tools available for that. So just the history of policy analysis. So why is policy even important for water? Well, management of water has always been political, and international water is more so. Unfortunately, river basins never follow boundaries of nations, so we've always had challenges with that. The Chinese had it right a long time ago. If you have the Han character, the Chinese character for river, and you have the character for dike, dike is a pond or a levee, you actually get political order. And this came from a time when the Chinese had the Mekong and the Yellow River. They would like to managing water was very important for civilization to grow. And in fact, it's the case with a lot of civilizations across the world. Early civilizations only developed in regions where there was ample supply of water and there was warm temperatures. And that's not surprising because we have in our own civilization goes back along quite thousands of years. We had the Indus Valley civilization, the Egyptian civilization, Mesopotamia, and the Chinese civilization. But control and policy was very important in managing these civilizations. In fact, in Egypt, it was the earliest civilization that practiced basin irrigation. And in fact, there's a German-American historian called Wittfogel who wrote a book called Oriental Despotism. You can disagree with it, but his argument was that centralized governments were only able to successfully rule because they controlled water supply. And it was, you know, they were able to grow a lot of crops. So there was a lot of preoccupation in those times to grow their civilizations and had food security. In the Indus Valley civilization, the focus was on water supply and developing sanitation systems and grow this entire civilization. Rome was able to grow because they were able to divert great water from great distances. In fact, it was the earliest city, as we call it, and trade also developed. But it was always contentious who's getting the water. Everybody fought over it. So then, the first policy report that we ever got was through Frontinus. Julius Frontinus was a judge. He was not an engineer. He was a judge. And then he became the senator. And then he was appointed the second highest rank next to an emperor, which is the water commissioner of Rome. So water engineers had it a long time ago. Right now, nobody cares about us, but back then, we were close to the emperor. And he wrote this treatise on the aqueducts of Rome. You can actually, on the website, go and get the translated version, where he looked at the entire law that should be developed to ensure that there is no theft of water. He made measurements, so he said it. He was a judge who used numbers. He didn't say water is being stolen. He went, monitored, he measured the dimensions of each of the aqueducts. And in fact, these aqueducts still exist. So this is Rome, and this is the road, but this used to be a canal where water used to flow through. This is also an existing Rome. So if you ever have a chance to go there, do visit it. And so he also talked about the kind of institutions that need to be developed because he was a lawyer, but he used methods of an engineer. But policy analysis today is quite different and the discipline has grown. Its policy analysis differs from policy making in that it uses systems analysis, operations research, and other tools and methods developed in the 19th and 20th century to inform policy making. So it's a very systematic examination of a public problem, which means you will look at a problem, you will look at different options that can manage that problem, then you will weigh the pros and cons, the outcomes, based on particular set of objectives or criteria, and then make your most educated decision. It's also an analytical process, so you'll have analytical tools, you'll have maps to support it, you'll have computers to help you make the most optimum decision. There are many methods, and there's no global model, but we use a broad model where we define the problem, determine the criteria that we will use to see how our different alternatives rank, and evaluate our policy options, and finally select the preferred policy that seems to rank the highest based on selected criteria. This model was developed by Herbert Simon. It's called the Rational Model. It was developed in the 1700s. And it's the basic model you use for systems analysis as well. So you must have seen this chart. And it seems very straightforward, but most people actually don't use it, right? So you want to move from ad hoc policy making to policy analysis, where you can trace the steps of coming to a decision and know where you went wrong. And it's an iterative process because once you implement, you make a mistake and then you learn and you improve. Because without trying, you aren't going to be learning. And so just a brief history of how this method developed. After World War II, the Allies felt that they used systems analysis in the war and they felt that they made the best strategic decisions. So they decided, let's introduce it in the military. A lot of corporations in the West started using systems analysis for policy making. They developed schools, all the public administration and public policy schools started teaching systems analysis. Then Robert McNamara, also was World Bank president, started introducing it there. So later on, there were a lot of applications and over time, just like systems analysis, policy analysis, used a lot of analytical methods, and it entered water resources problems during the 1960s, where there was a program of welfare introduced by President Lyndon Johnson. So this is just a brief overview. So the kind of approach that I've learned, and I'll suggest that for all of you, is called the eightfold path to policy making. I mean, there are different versions. It's an extension of the rational model. And this this process was introduced by Eugene Bardet, who's a retired economist from UC Berkeley. He was in the School of Public Policy. This is a book, you can actually find it, and it's pretty good. And it has a series of steps that you should follow to come to a solution of a problem, but you don't have to follow exactly those same steps, but broadly those are good, and it has a lot of steps to help you have the best options available for yourself and not narrow your decision-making skills. And you use trial and error, and it's an iterative process. So this is how it's like eight steps, and I'll go over each. And you'll be surprised how it helps you go through a problem. It's very basic. So you define the problem, and this looks very simple. You assemble evidence that shows that there is a problem, actually. You construct the alternatives. You develop different management options to come, resolve this problem. Then you select the criteria that are important to you. Cost may be important, effectiveness. And then you analyze or project the outcomes. You make your best intelligent guess that if we follow this option, what could happen? What is the worst or the best scenario? And then you confront those trade-offs. Am I going to be okay with this decision if I take it, and what are the trade-offs? And then I decide, and then you tell your story. You can definitely tweak around 3, 4, 5, but the idea is just go through a rational process to resolve the problem. So defining a problem seems very simple for most people. Can one of you raise a hand and tell me what could be a basic problem for a student at NAMS? Let's say you're in your senior year, your last year student. Yes. ATM class. Okay, that's your, you think that's your, okay. So let's break down the problem. That's actually not the problem. The problem is you have to go to class so that you can get a job, so that you can provide a livelihood. At the end of the day, everybody has the same thing. They want a livelihood. They want food, water, and a general good quality of life at the end of the day, right? So there are, but the scale of the problem depends. So what I'm trying to say is a lot of times we make the solution a problem, right? So if you are a Punjabi or a Sindhi, you can say Kala Bagh is a big problem. Well, maybe it's actually not. The problem is water reliability. It's not even the amount of water, but water reliability. That we don't get water at the time we need it, at the place we need it. We get it whenever Vata decides to give it, or whenever Sarvela is operated, right? But we made a conscious decision to have it operated in a particular way to optimize agriculture and have trade-offs with energy and with other things. So a lot of times we create problems where that's not really a problem, it's a solution. But at the same time, it can be a problem, right? So if the silting in a particular reservoir is a problem, that is a problem because you're reducing storage capacity. So you address different sets of management options for that. But whenever you have a problem, say it with numbers. Don't say Pakistan is a poor country, but say it by showing how many percentage of people live under the poverty line and what is the poverty line mean. And missing an opportunity is also a problem too, right? So if you continue on the path that you are already on this, it's known as the status quo path, or you continue business as usual, you may miss out some very good opportunities. So investment opportunities, that's a problem too. And of course, the problem will depend on the client that you have. Or if it's a policymaker, it's going to have a different problem. And the scale, so and the level they have. So if you have a municipal county head, and then you have a provincial head, and then you have the president, you cannot expect them to have the same problems. And you cannot expect them to weigh the same problems. Just because all of us are water professionals does not mean water is the biggest problem facing this country. It can be, but it may not always be. And so sometimes it's important to think outside of our professions and what we see as a problem and really address the person who's making a decision what really is a problem. And then we assemble some evidence. Basic mass balance is the best option. If you think that numbers are fudgy, please, you know, that's just basic math. 1 + 1 = 2, never 3. And use analogies. An analogy here means when you say Pakistan gets 100 million acre feet on average each year, for most of us who are people in the water sector may know. But using analogies such as Pakistan only has 30 days of storage, whereas countries in the West have up to 900, 2 to 3 years. So it shows a comparison of where you rank. And then use analogies over time as well. So to say Pakistan's per capita water availability today is 1,000 meter cube per year may not, you know, I won't understand how much that means. But when you say in 1951 it was 5,650 and it's expected to decrease to 800 in 2026, it shows that it gives a better comparison of how the rate of water available to us is lower now. We had much more and much less now. So we have a problem, we've gathered evidence and we've established it is a problem. Now you think of solutions, and here don't think of the same solutions that are just always thrown at you, but be innovative and creative, but not that innovative and creative that you know it can never happen. So we translate what our goals and objectives are into alternatives. We develop all the range of options. Our one option, which is always going to be there, is continuing on the same path. It is the status quo, and that you must always weigh. If you continue on this same path and do nothing about the problem, what can happen? And if you do something, what can happen? There's another option that I would always suggest is when you enter into a policy-making decision, you always have a background. It's the best alternative to a negotiated agreement, or I call it best alternative to no alternative, which means it is the lowest policy that I want to come out with. If I am going to the chief minister and I'm saying, I'm taking his time, I must go there with saying, I will at least get something out of him. Yesterday, Rafi said 2 million acre feet, that is the least thing I'm going to get. So that's your path now. It's not going to be the best option. In fact, it's going to be the second worst option. So your worst option might be status quo. But this is the minimum thing you want to come out because you are going in this entire policy making decision, the framework. So start with a huge comprehensive list, portfolio of options, and then focus them. And there's not always a silver bullet solution. You can probably have a range of solutions. And reduce and simplify the list. But also, a lot of us, you know, think of solutions which have been tried and tested, but sometimes it's important to try new things and pilot and innovate. Selecting the criteria. So how many of you have actually understand what criteria are? So can somebody raise their hands and perhaps suggest what is a criteria that they would use. If they were to, if I give one of you 100 rupees, and then I say you have 3 options, you can go shopping, you can go to Joyland, or you can go to a restaurant, right? What are the criteria that you will use to make your best informed decision?
100 rupees is not enough.
That is true, but let's just say that's the thing. So cost is a criteria, right? So your decision is going to be 100 rupees might not be enough for Joyland, or maybe it is, I can pay the entry fee and take one ride and get nothing else, or I can go to a very cheap restaurant, or I can really buy some really bad shopping items. But those are your criteria. Your criteria is cost, right? The time, yeah, what are your objectives, right? So it's a valid point. When you have to make these decisions, cost is a very important criteria. And these criteria in optimization models are your objectives. What is it that you're actually trying to do? So sample criteria for improving river water quality might be, so if you have effectiveness, how much of an improvement in water quality will this alternative produce? So that's one question you have to ask when you're evaluating the option based on this criteria. Effectiveness means how good an option is in solving that problem, right? So if I think there is a water shortage and I say the solution is a desalination plant, right? It may not actually be very effective because it may not deliver the scale. A reservoir might be very effective, depending on how large it is. So effectiveness outside of cost looks at how good is this management option in solving this problem. And the cost is always, you know, a criteria that you put in. You're going to make an investment. You want to get the best out of that investment. So how much will it cost to improve the quality of river using this alternative? Then there's technical criteria. It's like, do we really think we can do it? Do we really have the technical know-how? So do we have the equipment and know-how to use this alternative? So developing a state-of-the-art, you know, machinery and giving it to a very poor farmer might not be effective because he will never be able to use it. Or do you have some options that will couple it with that option where you can give them capacity support? And political, is this alternative politically acceptable? So when you think about Kalabagh, it is not politically acceptable. So the chances of it happening are very thin. Projecting the outcomes is basically the analytical part. It's systems analysis, it's cost-benefit analysis, and in the second section, we'll go over all these, a few of these analysis methods. So we project the outcomes based on the fact, if we follow this option, what could happen? We project, we have to do modeling and simulation to say we're going to build a reservoir. How will the water security in this country look like? Or we're going to build a desal plant, or we're going to improve water efficiency. So we have to use some analytical method to actually say how much improvement we've had. Also, there are negative effects known as externalities. So a lot of times, you do an option with the best intention, and you find out that it's created a bigger problem. So in the 1970s, there was a huge waterlogging and salinity problem in Pakistan. So at that time, Pakistan went to President Kennedy and said, we have this big problem, what do we do? At that time, tube wells came. So then, tube wells solved the problem of waterlogging and salinity. But it created another problem. There's over pumping and overuse, and tube wells have grown. So it's possible, and a lot of times you don't take care of those externalities. There are a lot of times you can't foresee what could happen. And then you confront the trade-offs. You project, and you confront what are the trade-offs. So, okay, if we do this, these are the trade-offs. If we do this, so does anybody have an example of a trade-off? So I want you all to engage. So anyone, raise hands. What is a trade-off? Okay, so same example, 100 rupees, Joyland restaurant shopping. What are the trade-offs? Nimra, since nobody is saying, I will point to you. Yes, trade-off. Absolutely. So, any other examples of trade-offs that?
Well, even the cost of the Joyland example, the cost and the amount of time it takes you to go from this place to that place.
Traffic, stress,
exactly.
Sleep or grade, absolutely huge trade-off, right? Should I have a full 8 hours of sleep or more, or should I go to class? So if it's probably recorded, then you say it's recorded, maybe I can take it later, right? So we use it in our daily life. So then you have trade-offs, you develop a trade-off matrix. You develop all your alternatives in your matrix rows, your criteria and your columns, and then you show your outcomes. So here's the criteria. So we have three options. And then criteria is complexity, how difficult this problem is. Flexibility, can this problem be changed later on? Is it so permanent that we will regret it later on? Resources, how much money, cost, land, labor, manpower. Integration, that can it easily fit into current practices? Time to implement, how much time does it basically take? Like we may have a very, if we're long-term planning, time might not be an issue. If we're short-term planning, if there's a flood and we're like, we have to make a decision now, time is very important. And so when you do some model and you establish ways, you can see how these options fare. And so we do 1 to 3 where 3 is best, and then option 3 scores 20. So we say this seems to be the best option. So a trade-off matrix in any policy report or analysis is very important, because you want to see, okay, maybe you can forget about these ways. Maybe in some situations resources might not be a problem. You might have infinite amount of money and you're like, I need to do something very, very good. I'm a philanthropist. So then you won't care about, yes.
Trade-off should be done by the group of people, otherwise it
could
be biased.
Yeah. Well, it depends on who is making the decision, right?
Then
most decisions are biased, but at the end, if the trade-off is made by a decision maker, and he has to weigh, in the analysis and in the entire process, it's done by everyone. But there are many methods. So, you know, when we were talking about objectives, there's a technique called Delphi technique where they try to come to the actual problem. So they give you a questionnaire, then they say, what's the problem, biggest problem? Then they define it, they give it to you again, then they say, what's the biggest problem? Then they define it again. And at the end, the problems converge to one. So, You have to actually take care of stakeholders in all processes, not just in this. You arrive to these things when you like have everyone. But when you're making federal policy, you and I are not going to, they won't really care what trade-offs we have. It will be federal policy, and you know, so the one who makes the decision, it will eventually be their final decision of what they are willing to live with. So decide. So again, you should put yourself in the shoes of a decision. So if you're a policy analyst, you have to put yourself in the shoes of the decision maker, which means like for a president, it might be gaining popularity among people, right? So agriculture might be a big issue in this country because the huge voter base is farmers. So people who live in the city, it might not be important to ensure that they get electricity all the time. floods might not be an issue because a lot of farmers still like flooding. And then the $20 bill test is, if your payment policy is such a great idea, how come it's not happening? So, you know, oftentimes we get outside of our everything. This is it. This has to be. I made this amazing solution. This has to be used. It is the solution to all problems. But if it's not being used, it's clearly not such a great option. And then you tell your story. So the report, the book actually tells a lot about background on how to write to policymakers. So if you are interested in, you know, becoming a good communicator of technical knowledge, I really recommend you read it. And also, don't blather as much. Keep it short and simple. I had to really learn a lot. You know, in fact, a policy memo is not supposed to be more than a page long and not supposed to have more than 150 words. So it's very hard. So then, as I said, when you're projecting the outcomes, we use many tools of analysis. So that brings us to our second section. And so there are many methods. There's cost-benefit analysis. So this evaluates all the costs of a project and all the benefits and compares them. And we'll go into it in detail of what these costs are. Then there's operations research and systems analysis. And you had an amazing module by Dr. Afreen. Dr. Afreen, she went over it and how it could be used to optimize our decisions. Then there's risk analysis, which is often used in assessing how much risk are caused by hazards like floods, droughts, and then sensitivity analysis, which can see which parameters must be focused on in a model, which policy decisions are sensitive to market or external exogenous shocks, external shocks. So in a cost-benefit analysis, it's not as straightforward as it sounds. In my first cost-benefit analysis that I was asked to do, there are a lot of indirect costs that nobody thinks of, right? So, how many of you have done a cost-benefit analysis? Or, go on? Oh, okay. You've done a cost-benefit analysis? Okay. So, I'm going to give you an example, sorry. So, if I was supposed to do a capacity building program for Barbara, I'm saying, I'm going to give Barbara money to improve the capacity and caliber of these people. How are you going to weigh the how are you going to measure the benefits?
First of all, it's going to be the all the budgeting, like installation.
So those are the costs.
Yeah,
but the benefits.
The benefits would be how much revenue it's going to generate at the impact of the cost.
So see, the generating revenue may not. When you're doing a capacity building project, how do you know what revenue you're going to get? What is the cost benefit analysis of this workshop? So it's actually very difficult because they're very difficult things to quantify. A cost benefit analysis only looks at money. So you use dollar or rupee values for everything. So there are a lot of costs that we don't think. In cost, there's opportunity cost. I've invested in something, but I'm losing out on the other options. Lost time and externalities. There are a lot of negative things that can happen, which I will not ever take into account in the cost. And then there are intangible benefits like knowledge, damage avoided, societal benefits, capacity building. So actually doing a cost-benefit analysis requires looking at all what could possibly happen and how are you going to put it in a rupee term. And then, over time, there's also, so you have to make also a few other adjustments, and those are time adjustments. So a rupee, 100 rupees today may be worth something. In another 10 years, it might be worth nothing. So its value will decrease. So then you use a discount factor. So there are, you know, three forms of representing it. You know, when you've done a, you've summed up the cost, summed up the benefits. So when you are trying to represent, then you use three values. Net present value is basically you subtract the benefits and from the cost, but then you also make sure that they're at their present value, right? So if you expand this, it's benefits minus cost over 1 plus discount factor first year. And then it goes on, and this end is the time period. For example, if the net present value of $1 profit at the end of the year, if the discount rate, and the discount rate is usually between 5 and 7%, so it's 1 over 1 plus 0.05, this is 5%. And then, so at the end of the year, this $1 value decreases to 0.95, and usually there's a decrease. Then you can also represent it in internal rate of return. This is a bit difficult because what you do is you calculate the discount. This is like you solve for this R. You solve for this R and you make this zero, right? So, but then you can only solve it numerically. So, you know, in a lot of studies they still do it, but in it's very difficult. So a quick thing is what they use is return on investment. So the return on investment is the benefits minus cost at their present values over the costs. So we'll do an example after this. And the benefit cost ratio is the benefits over the cost, but at their all present values. And this is benefit minus cost over the cost. So here we have two programs. So, and these are present values. I'm sorry, it's not clear here. So program A has benefits of 8 million present value. So we don't need to, so forget about the discount factor here. And the costs are 3 million here. And then program B is 17 million and 10 million. So net present value, just think of it as the profit, right? After the period of time, it's 7 million here and 5 million here. So if I just look at the net present value, I'm making a profit in both, and this one I'm making more profit, right? So here's the calculation. So the benefit cost ratio is 8 over 3 for this one, right? And then it's 2.67. So benefit over cost. Then the return on investment is 5 over 3, so it's 8 minus 3 over 3. And that gives you 1.67, and then you can convert it into a percentage. And then the net present value is simply 8 minus 3, right? So when you look at all of these projects, so you look at the net present value, you think program B is better, but if you look at the benefit cost ratio, you will see that A is better. And both in, you know, both terms can be used. It will completely depend. But a lot of times, net present value is a better indicator of how much in terms of money. Sometimes the benefit cost ratio is, it's not often very reliable. And it depends on whether it's a public project, private project, what your motivations are. But these are just some forms of how you can represent your, you know, analysis of an economic analysis. Then you have operations research. And so you went over the Pareto optimal curve. So this is just the other way around. So on your y-axis, you're trying to minimize environmental impacts. Okay? So you have, say, you have different projects to do some, you're trying to do water quality, or so you have a treatment plant, you may have a desal plant, you may have a few different options. And then you have costs on your x-axis, and you're trying to minimize because you want a project that has the lowest cost, that has the lowest environmental impact. And then you can just plot all of your options, right? So you plot how much they cost, what their environmental impact is. If you can actually draw a line through the options that are on the edges, that's your Pareto optimal curve. These options are your portfolio of options And the ones you choose will depend on what matters more to you. These are your criteria or your objectives. So if environmental impacts matter, if you're an environmentalist, you would be here. And if you don't care about the environment, you're just like, I need to save money. These matter. So depending on where you are, you will choose your option. It looks like you're going from here to here over time, hopefully. So risk analysis is another method. So risk is looking at what is the magnitude of the hazard, and then what is the exposure and vulnerability to that hazard. So a hazard is something like a flood, a drought, earthquake, some shocks. And so the magnitude, so if you look at flood risk, the magnitude can be calculated through different things. The extent of flooding, the duration of flooding, the depth of flooding. And then it also matters what the frequency of that flood is. Because if I'm going to get a flood in one in every 1,000 years, I'm not going to invest in anything. I'm like, okay, one in 1,000 years, I'll take that risk. If I'm going to get a flood every year in the monsoon season, I'm going to be incurring a lot of losses each year. So I really need to think about it. But then it's also exposure. So if a farm is getting flooded with no people on it, no investments, maybe cheaper investments, it may not matter. But if a crowded city where I have so much investments, industries, then I have more at stake. So the investment in, that you're trying to protect will also matter in your analysis. And then vulnerability. This is difficult to measure, susceptibility, resilience, that you know, people who are used to getting flooded each year, they've developed more resilience. They're used to living, they can adapt to situations. So all of these three components go to doing a risk analysis. And there, even within a risk analysis, it's very, for each kind of risk, it's done very differently. So floods, you have different tools to do it. And then you represent your risks in a risk matrix, so in a policy report, you will always see this. So if you see a flood report, earthquake report, drought report, you'll see something like this. It says, how likely, what is the frequency of this thing happening? So if it's very likely, risks are higher. If it's unlikely, risks are lower. And what is the impact? Is it a minor, moderate, or major impact, right? So if you have a very small flood that happens very unlikely, frequency of it occurring is there. So the risk is also low. But if you see huge floods happening that cause devastating impact and happen very regularly, the risks are very high. And then sensitivity analysis. So sensitivity analysis is used in, it's on its own a method, and it's also a method used alongside all methods. Have any of you done a sensitivity analysis? Okay. So if you're an engineer, I highly recommend always do a sensitivity analysis. So it's a method of determining how sensitive our model results are to parameter values. So if I was doing, how many hydraulic engineers or civil engineers are there? So I'm doing a hydraulic model. And so I have many Zen, and then I've decided I also want to gather some data about depth, right? And then I also want to gather some data about water slope. So we use slope, right?
Discharge.
So we have discharge, right? So we have a few options. And so, So this is Manning's, and this is our roughness coefficient, right? So I'll see, we need to cut this out. We'll have slope and discharge. And so if we solve the 1D hydraulic model, we get the output is the water surface elevation. Okay? So a hydraulic model, what it really for the non-engineers, these are your inputs of data. You input this and you get this as an output, right? Water surface elevation is basically, this is your channel, this is the elevation of water in it. That's it, right? So you put these three things in it, and then you get your water surface elevation. So you all use 111 value, and then you get the same, you get one answer. But then I have decided I'm going to improve the quality of my data. But I can only improve the quality of one input. Unfortunately, I don't have enough money. I can go out, fix my manning then, or I can go determine the slope or the discharge. What I'm going to do is sensitivity analysis to see how this water surface elevation varies if we increase this by 10% or decrease it by 10%, or increase this by 10% or increase. So what you do is you vary these, and these are arbitrary values. You see how this changes with respect to this. It's a basic regression. It's a basic like relation, like how are they related. And the parameter that will be the most sensitive is the one that I will want to put my money in to improve the quality, because my results are so determined on that data. If they are not sensitive, I may not even need them. There doesn't seem to be a relationship. So it helps us where to spend money. How do we change a parameter and what happens? So suppose you have one case of cost price, sales price, profit loss. And then you, in the best case, you increase these things, and in the worst case, you reduce these things. So this is just to show if you increase yield by 10% and, or in the worst case, you decrease it by 20%, how does your cost price change? How does your sales price change? So if you look at it, sales price is not changing much when we change yield and all of the other things. But these don't seem to change, but the cost price changes. The other parameters seem to be much more sensitive. This one doesn't seem to change much. So it's just to show that if you change inputs, how much do your outputs change? So, well, those are just some basic methods for them. What is like, we're not rational people, we create problems, and so, yes? No. So you usually have to plot it, right? So what you're going to do is you're going to plot, say, water surface elevation, and then you can plot all three. So you can say mannings, slope, and discharge. And so you have this, and then you have this, right? So say mannings goes like this, slope goes like this, and then this goes like this. So this is the most sensitive, and use the same thing in it, right? This seems to be the most sensitive, so I need to invent. But for every river, it's going to be different, right? There are, so the Indus River is more sensitive to climate change because it's more sensitive to temperature because it's glacially fed. Rain-fed rivers aren't, the discharge is not as sensitive. So it's actually an interesting exercise to see the sensitivity of the system to shocks.
So just to be clear, those relationships can be more complex. So
then you would have they're not linear always, exactly. So definitely, if it's curved, then you want to choose something that's not very sensitive. Sensitivity is important for uncertainty too. So we come to water conflicts. So I mean, we have so many, there are a lot of causes of disputes, right? So water is a resource that's needed for our livelihood, but it's also an economic good. So people are going to fight over it, and it's always a problem when it's scarce, right? When you have a lot of water, you're not really going to necessarily fight over it. And power dynamics, whether you're the lower riparian or the upper riparian. And again, water is not in boundaries, right? So it doesn't decide that coming from Tibet and if this is coming, it doesn't say, oh, let's just stay in some other country and not go back to Pakistan. You know, so fortunately, water doesn't do that. So, you know, this is a global map. Already the ones in red basins are already in conflict. So briefly talk about the Nile conflict very briefly, but I'm not an expert on it, but I will discuss some of the players. Pakistan, India are, you know, they're at risk, but so far with the Indus Waters Treaty, we've done pretty well. The treaty has survived wars. But the key question is, it's only an issue because in countries, it's a source of conflict in countries where water is important and your economy is dependent on it. So Pakistan's economy depends a lot on water, but for a lot of countries, the economies don't depend on it. So if you actually plot, this was a study done by the RAND, where they plotted rainfall variation around the mean. So they calculated the mean annual rainfall in that year and then looked at the variability. And then they plotted GDP growth. And in Ethiopia and Zimbabwe, they found strong correlations, right? Almost looks like it's fudged up data, but it looks perfect. And this is the variability. So these countries really depend on water and the GDP depends on it. And these are just indicators to show that in economies, in countries where the economy is so dependent on water, water will be a huge source of conflict. So we do have a mathematical means of solving some of these conflicts, and it's called game theory. Have any of you heard of game theory? Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, yes. Exactly, it gives us very interesting insights. So what is game theory? It basically is a method where they try to look at acceptable strategies in conflict situations. It's highly mathematical, and it assumes that all human interactions can be understood and that human beings are rational or decision makers are rational. So in this we plot the players. So the decision makers are called the players. They can be two-person or multi-person games. Each player can choose between two or more choices. Every player has choices, and every player is aware of what will happen to him if he takes that option. They will act rationally. Every decision will lead to a win, a lose, or a draw. And so the win could be, it's not just like a 1-0 value, it could be like, there could be bigger wins or smaller wins, so you can check their magnitude. The rules of the game and the payoffs for each player are known by all participants. So the payoff is going to be whether it's a win, a loss, or a draw. And the payoff or outcome is at the end of the game, and they are represented in the form of a matrix. And they determine what type of game is played. And then there are equilibrium points. So we're going to go through an example. There are two very well-known games. There's a prisoner's dilemma and chicken. So here. So there are two people who committed a crime. They've stolen water from a canal, and the irrigation department puts them to jail. So they're two farmers, and so one, they ask him, who did it? But they're individually interrogating. So one person is said, look, if you confess, then I will only, now here's it looks. So if the farmer confesses, he has two options. If he confesses and the other person doesn't, he will be let off. and the other person who doesn't confess will spend 20 years in jail, right? So if this guy confesses and this one remains silent, he stays in jail for 20 years and this one gets up. On the other hand, he decides, oh, I'll confess, that one won't. But he also confesses, oh, then they end up 5 years each. So both of them are crying in jail, right? So both farmers get nothing out. If he says, let's remain silent, and this guy confesses, then it's the other way around. This guy is put in jail for 20 years, and he stays for 0 years. If they both don't speak, they say, no, I'm not telling. It's just 1 year. So it's very frustrating for... Yeah, so the best option actually, so if you were to do optimization model on this, right? So if you were to do an optimization model, this one is the best option because chalo ek saal hi guzar lenge dono, 2 saal jail mein irrigation department bhi paare hoga, right? If both of them confess, 5 saal rahenge, matlab. So, but you know, human beings are not very rational. Because although this is the optimal solution, game theory will predict what is consent. Right? So, yes. Okay. So, there are 2 farmers, they've stolen water. Nobody knows who actually stole it, right? The irrigation department interrogates them. They were giving that authority to the irrigation department, right? So, I'm the inspector and I just say, look, if you confess and the other person also confesses, then you will both go to jail for 5 years. If you confess and he doesn't confess, then you will be let go, and he will stay in jail for 20 years. However, it could also be the other way around, right? So if the other person, he says, he remains silent, and the other person confesses, he stays in jail for 20 years. And if they both remain silent, it's 1 year, right? Each. But I don't know whether that other farmer is nice enough to stay silent. I don't trust him. Yes, that's a smart farmer. They thought next time they steal, they will do that. But you don't. If you don't trust him, he might default. Like, well, no. So here's another thing. I'm a Punjabi farmer and you're a Sindhi farmer and we have this agreement, right? And he said, just spend 1 year and that's it. Let's steal as much water. And then one of the Punjabi one, ha 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 ha, you know what? I will actually confess and I won't even spend a year in jail. So how do you trust people? And to be honest, that's the dilemma we are in, right? Yeah, so eventually, what's going to happen, that's exactly what happens. They both confess. So, this solution is called the Nash equilibrium solution. And what it basically... So this is like the number, this shows the number of years you will spend in jail. So if he... वो जुर्म साबित का सवाल ही नहीं है मैंने कहा है कि आप बताएं ना बनवाएं तो ऑप्शन भी दिए हैं ये साल चेंज करने कोई मतलब नहीं ये मतलब असूल हाँ हाँ मतलब मैं ऑप्शन दाई जी अदर प्रॉब्लम Exactly. And so, if you look at the system as a whole, right, you use a systems approach and say, बेस्ट ऑप्शन इज दोनों कुछ ना बोले और एक एक साल जेल में बिता. लेकिन हम मतलब इतने अच्छे नहीं है, हम लोग कहेंगे नहीं 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 हम तो बता ही देते हैं, शायद हम लकी हो जाए, लकी नंबर निकल आए, लकी नंबर नहीं निकलता और दोनों जेल में चले जाते हैं 5 साल. इट्स अ शॉर्टर टाइम, इट्स लेस देन 20. सो दिस सॉल्यूशन, द नैश इक्विलिब्रियम सॉल्यूशन फ्रॉम गेम थ्योरी, इज अ स्टेबल सॉल्यूशन व्हिच शोस इट इज द बेस्ट ऑप्शन फॉर दैट पर्सन. It gives the highest payoff, and no other. If he acts unilaterally, he will not get a better option. Unilaterally means अगर सिर्फ एक ही बंदे दूसरी एक decision करे, उसे उसे बेहतर कोई फायदा नहीं मिलेगा. तो अगर ये सिर्फ ये एक decision नहीं लेगा, तो he can only go here, right? It's up to him. He has two options. If he unilaterally takes the decision, this is what he can get. So Nash equilibrium is the best decision under game theory, which won't give you a better payoff if you act unilaterally. So then there's another thing. It's called the game of chicken. It comes from when we chicken act. So you have two cars, right? They are speeding at one another. Main Boulevard pe aa rahe hain, theek hai? तो इफ ड्राइवर ए दोनों अगर गेट आउट ऑफ द वे, दैट्स द बेस्ट थिंग, ठीक है, देयर सेफ, राइट. अगर ये सीधा चला जाए, द अदर वन विल हैव टू स्वर्व, राइट. सो ही स्टिल स्टेज ऑन द पाथ, ही विन्स एंड द अदर वन लूजेस, राइट. सो दैट्स हाउ वी से विन लूज. ही गेट्स आउट ऑफ, ही कंटिन्यूज गोइंग, ही चिकन आउट, नो नो आई डोंट वांट टू डाई, लेट्स गो. On the other hand, ये बड़ा जीत है, ये नहीं हिलता, ये चलता जाता है. This one decides, oh, I need to save myself, so he swerves. This guy is on his path, he wins, the other one loses. And दोनों जीत हैं, तो दोनों crash, right? So what eventually happens in this is the Nash equilibrium are these two. There are two options, one of them. Both options say that one will swerve and the other won't. Why? Because self-preservation is more important. So these are just examples. In real life, it gets more complicated, of course. So these are two kinds, types of beings. So some vocabulary related to it. A dominating strategy, and this is similar to in even systems analysis. It's a strategy that dominates another. If it always gives a better playoff to the player, it weakly dominates the other strategy if it is always at least as good. So if there is an option, and if you know, if you get a more complicated matrix, if there is an option there, no matter what the other person does, you will always get the best solution by going in a particular direction that is going to be a dominant, yeah, for yourself. Doesn't matter what the other person does, that's your dominating strategy. And as I discussed, Nash equilibrium is a list of strategies, one for each player, which has the property that no player can unilaterally change his strategy and get a better payoff. And then there's also zero-sum game, which I want to discuss as well. A game is said to be zero-sum if for any outcome, the sum of the payoffs to all players is zero. In a two-player zero-sum game, one player's gain is the other person's loss. So their interests are diametrically opposed. So in a non-cooperative game often, like if I know, if I have a finite resource that cannot be increased, right, or something, and I'm sharing it, I will share from myself. So yeah, so it's a win-lose situation. One party wins, the other loses, or the other loses and one wins. There is no other. A lot of times when we are in huge conflicts on water, we think it's a zero-sum game because we can't increase the quantity of water. But we can convert that zero-sum game into a non-zero-sum game by expanding outside of water and then using other tools to have negotiations. So, you know, we discussed these two games, and here's a here's just a matrix of outcomes. And so, by the way, these instead of years, what this means is higher value is better, lower value is worse, right? So this is just to show the number of years. So in this one, this was a Nash equilibrium, and this is the optimal solution. So it's the high payoff, right? So it's in payoff, when you're representing in a matrix, it's the number, right? It's not the penalty that you face, but the win, right? So, and in the chicken game, you have these two as your Nash equilibriums. So, and this one was your optimal solution, right? These two were, three threes were optimal. So there's a rule of thumb method when the when they get very, very difficult, right? So usually when you have to determine the Nash equilibrium, this is just a very small, you know, two matrices are nice, but when you have 10 matrices, how do you find the Nash equilibrium? The rule of thumb is the first number is the largest number in its own column, and the second number is the largest number in its own row. So there's a husband and wife. They're fighting over what to watch on TV, right? So we have Pakistan, India match, or Hamsafir match, you know, right? So it's very, very hard. So, you know, this is the best option. Wife watches Hamsafir, husband watches. This is the best option. So I've not done the Nash equilibrium for this. I believe that Nash equilibrium will eventually be these two. Yeah, but you know, there are better, there are a few games where it's not always win-lose situation. So there's a stag hunt game, which shows that, you know, if you work independently, you won't get any losses. It won't be too bad. So stag hunt game basically says if you, there are two people, farmers, there are two hunters. And if they work independently, both of them will only catch hares, right? If they both cooperate, they'll catch a big stag. They'll get a better, you know, they'll get a better award. So in most cases of this, you know, in the world, it's stag hunt. Nobody bothers with someone else. But what they're doing is they're missing out on opportunity. So if there are two very poor countries that are neighboring one another, they don't decide to cooperate and go on their own development agendas. If they decide to share knowledge and cooperate, they may make some huge progress towards reducing poverty. No, well, that's a, not, I mean, you don't have to say one, that's fine. You change the name, payoffs. So just an example, so this is just a real world example. There's a paper by Kaveh Madani. They've used a game theory approach to understanding the Nile Basin concept. And so game theory, when it comes to water resources, it gives us insights. It doesn't give us a solution, an optimal solution. It gives us insight as to how human beings can act or decision makers can act. So, has anyone been or seen or heard of the Nile? So it's the longest river, and it's shared by a number of African countries. So, Egypt has the main right. 96% of the population live in the delta. They've established historic uses over it. Only get 4% from the underground reserves. Also, just to tell you, so this is the main Nile, right? And this section is the white Nile, and then you have the blue Nile, right? So those are, but the white Nile is the main. So it's also very powerful. It has, it uses a lot of intimidation to make sure that it has all the power on the water. Thank you. you also have Sudan. And Sudan is, so in, how do you, you know, in our childhood we say chamcha. So Sudan is a chamcha of Egypt. Like, people agree to, you know, it doesn't want anything bad. Like, I would think it's always historically sides with Egypt on matters. 60% of the land mass is in the region. It's in the Civil War, and it's also very common. And then you have Ethiopia. And it generates 85% of the water reaching Egypt's Aswan Dam, and it's the main, it gives a lot of water because it's the source where the Blue Nile goes through. And it's also the second most populated region. So it's very populated. And so right now, everybody is following this 1959 treaty. It says that 75% goes to Egypt and 25% goes to Sudan, and rejected by all other Arabian states when they become independent. So they all are fighting over the water. So it's been a huge conflict. So it seems the goals, there were a lot of people who came in this, and they suggested, let's have a Nile Basin Initiative. Let's review this and let's reject 1959 treaty and have a Nile Basin Initiative. And it's a cooperative program where they will look at allocations, they will look at historical uses, they will look at optimal uses, and then, you know, agree to make the most out of the water that they have. And Kenya, I believe, has also gone to war with Egypt. And Egypt has said any country that develops its water resources. So also, Egypt is, I'm not certain how, but I've not studied it so much, but Egypt is also downstream. They're upstream, yeah, so the upstream nations are Kenya, so it flows this way, right? So in this situation, Egypt is a downstream riparian, but it has the most power. So to always think that upstream riparians have more power is a fallacy. So this dispute is there. Kenya has gone to war with Egypt. Egypt has said any country that develops its water resources, we will wage a war against them. And so it has the strongest military, so it actually can follow through with that. So the paper used a game theoretical approach and used the graph model for conflict resolution, decision support system. It draws on game theory, it's not game theory. And it was developed at University of Waterloo, Nimra's alma mater. So what you need are basically, it's a complete modeling tool. And so you have two inputs that you give in. So first you give the players and the options. So how they modeled it is they had Egypt as a player, then they had Sudan as a player, then Ethiopia, and then they clumped all the upstream nations into one. So upstream nations, Kenya, there are a lot of other countries, but Kenya is the main one. And so they've given three options to them, each one. So they can continue adhering to the 1959 treaty, or they could cooperate under the Nile Basin Initiative, or they independently develop water with the risk that Egypt might retaliate. Ethiopia, it has the same option, Sudan too. Egypt, on the other hand, has adherence to the treaty, cooperation under the Nile Basin Initiative, or develop military power and have sanctions or retaliate. So you input the players, you input the options, and then you also input preferences, right? So these are your, the players, right? These are their preferences. This is, if you ask each of the player, what is the preference? What do you want from, what do you want? So the upstream nations, firstly they want, we don't want Egypt to retaliate. Ethiopia that we don't want. So they all don't want, that's the first preference they have, right? So upstream in Ethiopia, they have the worst, they don't get much out of the treaty. So Ethiopia wants, we should abandon 1959 immediately. Upstream country says they're going to independently, IG means independently develop. So they want to independently develop their water resources if there is no retaliation. Sudan, you know, it is a chamcha, so it says let's continue on 1959, don't want Egypt to get too upset. Egypt does not want any, you know, of the countries, they don't want these two countries to develop. Then the third option, preference for the upstream is they cooperate under the Nile Basin Initiative. So Ethiopia independently develop with no retaliation, and Sudan cooperate if Egypt cooperates, and cooperate if Ethiopia cooperates. Egypt retaliation if independently develops, and cooperation if Sudan and Ethiopia cooperate. So this is upstream nations develop. And then the last preference for the upstream is abandoning 1959, and for Ethiopia, it's cooperate if Sudan cooperates. So these are just like their preferences, but in the end, all of them don't want Egypt to go to war. When you feed it, you got six stable outcomes. They're very similar. So one solution was that upstream nations, Ethiopia and Sudan, develop water independently and Egypt retaliate. And it was a stable solution, right? The other one is similar, that upstream nations and they develop, Egypt retaliates, and Sudan and Ethiopia though maintain the 1959 treaty. So Sudan does not develop here, it just maintains the treaty. But Egypt will still retaliate, right? Ethiopia develops independently and Egypt responds with retaliation. Egypt and the other nations maintain 1959. So here it's only Ethiopia is developing, but then Egypt still retaliates. So four is upstream nations develop independently, Egypt responds. Egypt and others maintain the treaty. So here Egypt does, it also responds with retaliation, but it maintains the treaty. Upstream nations develop independently and all others cooperate with each other. No retaliation occurs. Excellent. Upstream nations develop independently and Egypt retaliates. Egypt and others cooperate. There were two takeaways from this study. So Egypt retaliates a lot. Ethiopia and Sudan's strong aversion to retaliation is not enough to keep the region free from Egypt's retaliation, at least under equilibrium conditions. So it says that even though the preferences of each of the countries is that Egypt doesn't retaliate, it still is. And then the takeaway two was that the 4, 5, and 6 were stable. It shows Egypt would retaliate against the upstream nations if the lower three are working under the treaty, yet it's ambivalent towards retaliation against the upstream nations if they are cooperating. So the lower countries, they continue on the status quo on the treaty, is going to retaliate. But if they cooperate in the Nile Basin Initiative, Egypt may not retaliate. So that's an interesting way to Nile Basin. So the 1959 treaty doesn't seem to be working very effectively because Egypt still has wants to retaliate. So I mean, this is just a very good example of how they study and what kind of insights we can draw from game theory and game theoretic approaches. So just an overall review, we've looked at how water resources, policy and planning, it's an ancient problem. Quantitative analysis dates back to Roman times. Rational planning and eightfold path, they arose later. So this is the eightfold path, we identify, gather evidence, develop options, and then we looked at a few methods of analysis, right? And so conflict resolution planning requires using game theory to see insights as to how decision makers can act. And cooperation requires win-win situations, you can make those in win-win situations. And a lot of ways that you can make win-win situations is by saying, so if what it is, and we have to share it among people, maybe you can trade it with something else, right? You can trade, say, I'll give you more energy, you give me more water. They're always, that's why we have a globalized economy, right? One person, one country can't produce everything, can't have enough water. This is a world of inequity and extremes. And so GMCI is also another tool that draws on game theory, and it's an excellent decision support tool we can use for addressing some of these conflict resolution mechanisms. So some references and questions. Also, there's a quiz, so I do expect all of you to solve it. Questions? And quiz? Does everybody have a quiz? Please do the quiz. It's actually a lot of fun. So the treaty said that 70%, 75% of the water will go to Egypt. So Egypt has historic rights. Egypt has been using water for the longest. It has a huge population that depends on it. So it said, this is our water. The treaty stipulates 75% of water will go to Egypt. 25% to Sudan, because Sudan is not very, it cooperates with Egypt. It doesn't want any, it doesn't want wars or conflict, but it agrees always with Egypt. That's possible. You can ask me anytime. I'll be here.
So let's do it this way. Okay?
We are running out. Yeah.
So you can take this quiz with you. If you want, you can work in groups. Well, do your own solutions.
You've done two.
Discuss with each other, and then you can turn them in.
What? That's cheating. Three circles. Like, guess which one is the best.
Gather back there at 2 o'clock.